Because I have canvas that's a really wonderful piece of Belgian linen that, you know, I prepared by hand with rabbit blood and has a tone on it. And so in some very important sense, this painting is already off to a really great start. But I thought I would go through, introduce my palette, which I think is very important. When I teach my workshops, when I give a little demo of starting a workshop, I discovered the most extraordinary thing. At a certain point, I would give this introductory talk, and I was always end by begging, literally. At a certain point, I said to my students, really, I beg you, do not start your painting by making a circle around each, making an outline of each object and filling it in. Finally, you know, every time I'd be begging you not to do this, please, just for me. But they did it anyway, until I said, okay, next workshop came along. So I want everybody to get a brush out of their paint box. And while I'm talking, I want you to hold on to this brush, and I want you to feel the brush. And, you know, we talked about a brush and all the, you know, brush is sort of like a bow for musical instruments. You know, there are many different places to hold a brush, and it has a very different stroke depending on where you hold it. And I generally, I mean, there are times I want to choke up on it, but generally, I like to hold the brush, encourage my students to hold the brush fairly far back. And when you do that, you play with it like this, you really feel how the weight of the brush contributes to the stroke. It's very important. And in fact, I would argue that painting is a very physical act, like a dance, so you want to paint with your whole body and, you know, a lot of the energy and come out through the brush. So I said, okay, everybody get a brush. And while I'm talking, I want you to paint along with Elizabeth and, you know, and feel the motion and hold your brush and feel all the energy in the brush. And I want to tell you, that time I looked around the class and everybody was working on their canvas with this energy. There's a PhD, you know, there's some neurologist who's going to investigate this someday and figure it out, because I'm sure there's some connection between keeping some movement going and learning and memory. But I also think it's a really important lesson about pain. So, that said, my palette, you know, observe, goes from light to dark and from left to right. And in descending order of value, more or less values, I mostly use the paint from here to here are cadmiums. Well, you know, except for the ochre, but we'll get to that. And cadmiums, as you know, looking at this crowd, I think probably everybody knows, were developed in the Industrial Revolution when the artist's palette really changed. So before the Industrial Revolution, everybody was basically, you know, fudging it a bit, you know, was grinding up a few bugs, but mostly rocks. So basically painting the same way people did the cave paintings, with earth colors. And then the Industrial Revolution came along and we had, you know, there was an explosion of color for the artist. And the cadmiums came along around 1810, I think. And I really like cadmiums. They're a little bit, you know, I notice there are a lot of new movements in the representational world these days that have kind of put the cadmiums to the side. And it's true that if you absorb them through the skin or you eat them, they'll kill you. But other than that, I think they're really great. They have tremendous, they seem to be very light fast, very durable, and they have tremendous saturation. So you can get, you know, an intensity of color and chromaticism and power that was never available, you know, wasn't available until the 19th century. The problem with cadmiums is not how to get enough color, which was always a problem for the old masters. The problem with cadmiums is how to control the color. So when you're working with cadmiums, you want to find ways to control the saturation, control the intensity. But if you learn to do that, you have a very versatile instrument. So the other great thing about the cadmiums is through some mysteries of the manufacturing process, which I have no idea how it works, they can manufacture them in different ways. So they go from through the value scale through the chromatic scale simultaneously. So we have cadmium lemon yellow, cadmium yellow light, cadmium yellow medium and deep, and I'm sure you could all recite that, orange. This particular ochre, ochre comes in all different shades, of course. But in general, you know, loosely we call ochre the center of the palette. It's sort of halfway between white and black. And the middle is such an important part of any painting. You know, this painting's all about balance and relationships, and the middle is, middle. Without the middle you don't have relationship. But ochre is an earth pigment, and the earth pigments are, you know, they are wonderful in their own way. They're incredibly durable. Cave paintings were done with them. But they're very weak in intensity. And they're not powerful pigments. They're sort of thin pigments. So it's very, so when if you want to integrate them, sometimes if you want something that is ochre, so to speak, in color, and you're working with a cadmium palette, I often find it makes a lot more sense to mix an ochre from the cadmiums. And you can mix, I will say this boldly, you can mix any earth color from the cadmium palette. So you can get something as, in that sense, and I will demonstrate two ways to mix ochre. One is my much maligned, very dear friend, phthalo green. We'll get to the phthalos in a minute. One very, very simple way is you can take phthalo green and almost any cadmium and get it, or group of cadmiums, and get a range of ochre. So let me just grab a couple of these cadmiums and some phthalo. And the trick is, although I usually don't advocate overmixing your paint, but with phthalo, because of the size of the particle, which is very, very small, if you mix it very thoroughly, you see you get a beautiful, this is a very deep ochre, but I can make a yellow ochre that comes pretty close to matching the yellow ochre that we have. So here we have an ochre that is very similar to the, seems to be very similar, but it has a very different kind of vibration to it. It has much more power. It's not the only way to do it. You can use out of red, blue, and yellow, anything can be made. Almost anything, pretty much anything can be made. It's just a question of proportion. So another way to make ochre would be, I have to have a red light, a cobalt blue, and a yellow. And see what we can do with those. And I'm sure you can see that, yeah, I could do this endlessly, making, you know, green ochres and yellow ochres and red ochres and, you know, dark ochres and light ochres. I mean, you could just do it forever and come up with different things. So again, you know, we have another ochre through another pathway. One thing I really, you know, love for my students to get is to really learn command over the palette so that you can understand how to mix things and not, a lot of times when I'm teaching and I'm mixing something and see my student going, mix this color, that color, and the other color, and I'm like, don't worry about it. All you need to know is red, really, all you need to know is red, blue, and yellow. And also I think, you know, and I'll get into it in much greater depth, I think phthalo green is an amazing partner with the cadmiums to mix things because it has such vibration. I call it the, I'm jumping over a lizard, which I have a lot to say about too. I call it the anchovy of the palace. Horrible by itself, very distasteful, but it has such power to affect everything around it and make, you know, wonderful mixtures and add life into all kinds of things. And I remember saying to Frank Mason once, but I was, you know, it stopped being a young student, it was sort of the young artist, and saw Frank and I had all these thoughts percolating, and I had been looking at Rembrandt's and seeing this sort of greenish viridian thing, and I said, Frank, you know, they had that, what do we, you know, what do we do? And he kind of looked at me and said, you know, we have phthalo. I was like, oh, right, we have phthalo. Thank you. My paintings for the next 3 years were all green. It was horrible. Tom was so nice. He was like, oh, looks great. 10 years later, it's like, oh my God, I painted really green there for a while. I was learning. All right, so let me mix all of this together. Make a nice, beautiful ochre to add. At the same time, it's still good. It's still good. I have two earth colors on my palette, the ochre, and over here I have burnt umber. And with all that I've just said, you know, everything in painting, for everything that's true, the opposite is also true. They also play a role. because you can, because the earth colors are weak, sometimes they're very useful for draining some of the saturation out of a cadmium. So sometimes you want to really control. Yellows, for instance, are a very difficult pigment to handle. And sometimes, especially if you're painting a blonde or something, blonde's a color of hair, it's very hard to paint. And often, using either, you know, burnt umber or an ochre or something mixed with a yellow, it just can be a very, you know, it all depends on the situation and what you're painting and the overall harmony of what you're doing, but sometimes it's just the way you want to go. It's a good something to put into your bag of tricks, a way to kind of control a cadmium pigment is with an earth color. So it's, I'm glad to have them on the palette, although they're not the center of the way that I paint. So, moving down, we come to alizarin crimson, which of course is not unfortunately, the cadmiums kind of stop at red deep, so you're finished there. You can't go any further with that. And does anybody know what the alizarin stand, what the word alizarin, or how alizarin crimson got, do we call it alizarin? Anybody? Besides Tom. No ringers. Well, that's great. That gives me something to tell you. So, before alizarin crimson, we had rose madder. And there still is rose madder, but don't use it because it's a beautiful, beautiful pigment. And if you did the sort of spectrograph of it and see all the, you know, not only the color, but the sort of color harmonic overtones that there are to a pigment, you know, colors have overtones just the way musical notes do. So if you play a string instrument, or any instrument probably, but I'm partial to the strings, you know that you have a note and then you have all the other sort of secondary vibrations that make that note particularly beautiful, and color is the same way. So, and you can see it under a mass spectrograph, or with your eyes, because you can tell. And so rose madder, which is made from a root of a plant, and it was the original alizarin crimson. And the word alizarin is the Arabic word for that plant, or for root, I can't remember which one's one, but that's just how it got to be alizarin crimson. And the problem with it is that it's just extremely fugitive. It just disappears. So you go through the museums, not everything has been deliberately, practically everything, but not everything has been deliberately scrubbed by restorers. Some of it really just faded away, and especially when you see, I think in London at that, what is that? Wonderful little, the Wallace collection in London, there's a Velazquez with a beautiful sort of woman with it. In Venice is pretty good intact rose madder too. Incredible, I have no idea how that happened, but so anything is possible. So anyway, Industrial Revolution, anyway, people used it because it was all they had. There was no other red with that quality and it looked great while they were alive, so what do they care? And Industrial Revolution comes along when everyone, you know, took all the old pigments, lapis lazuli and rose madder, and they put them under microscopes and figured out what they were, and they manufactured the particles and made the pigments we have today, like ultramarine blue. And that's when we got alizarin crimson. It's not completely permanent. So the mass spectrograph of rose madder is like this, you have all these beautiful overtones. Alizarin crimson is more like that, and it's much more permanent, but not completely permanent. It still will fade. It's not good to use as a pure glaze. And, you know, for Winsor & Newton, it's the only permanence B. It's the only thing they sell that they say is permanence B. And then in the 1950s, the quinacridones came in, and they made permanent alizarin crimson. And it will stay forever. And the only problem with it is, it's hideous. So then, you know, you're down to this. So I don't know what to tell you. I can't live without it. But, so what I do is I mix with alizarin, the impermanent one, hoping that all the other little molecules will stabilize it. And I glaze with the horrible one because, you know, it's thinner. Maybe no one will notice how bad it looks. So that's the story of alizarin crimson. And then we get to the phthalos, which came at the beginning of the 20th century. And they're made out of cyanide. And I've talked about phthalo green. I love phthalo green. When I was a student, well, we had something called phthalo madness, as you may remember. When people fell too in love with phthalo and they started using it in landscapes, and then it was called phthalo madness. And in those days, I could never keep it in one place on my palette. And many artists have this problem. It just escapes. It gets on everything. You know, it's the pigment you find on the bottom of your shoe and in your hair. Why that one pigment? All right, here's a strange thing. Once I got, after the 3 years of green paintings, when I got control of the phthalo on the palette, I mean, in the paint, my paintings, never escapes on the palette anymore. It stays right where I want it. This is very interesting. I don't know. Okay, all my great talking falls apart when we get to the blues. And then we have the blues. So then I start a little mini value scale of blues, and we have cerulean, cobalt, ultramarine, which is, you know, industrially produced lapis lazuli, and black, because, which I hardly ever use, but I like to have it, because you're white, you're black, it ends. And then I have raw umber, burnt umber, which is here in this completely illogical place on the palette for kind of an interesting reason. It was in that we're considering adding you to our roster position. It was a probationary color. And now it's where I reach for it. And I don't want to mess with that, because I think that's important, you know, how you move, you know, this interaction is very important, where you expect a color to be. I don't want to interrupt my mental thinking. So that's why it's there. If you decide to use it, I mean, I would recommend putting, you know, as I have with ochre, putting it somewhere where it, you know, like there, where the value is correct. But I don't, because I don't. All right, so, as Tom would say, if I'm ever going to start painting. So, how to start a painting. Everything on the canvas, not outlined like a coloring book. You really could start with anything. I start with phthalo green and red light, but it's red and green. It's basically a form of umber. You know, I think Tom was starting with, last night, with black and cadmium red light, which is another form of umber. You know, basically you're starting with brown. Honestly, if I were in my studio starting this painting and had time to get the painting started and let it dry, I might sort of swish around with some parts of it red, sort of a almost like an underpainting stain. I mean, honestly, with this, let me just start with the phthalo, having said that. If I were really doing this in my studio, I might put an understain of sort of a phthalo green under that rich brown bowl and a red under the green apples, you know, just in the back of your mind. But since we're just doing a quick demo here, we'll mix these together very loosely. I'm actually using just solvent as a medium at this point. And you know, the first thing I would do would be to just get the whole rhythm of the painting going. You know, just get a sense of, wow, that looks so different than it does in natural light. Would call the action of it, and get a feeling for where I want things placed and their relative weight. Now, this doesn't mean I'm necessarily, you know, never going to move anything, because it's not really what I'm thinking about. I'm just thinking about and, you know, getting a general sense and also kind of feeling the placement, the character, the action. God, I'm looking at a foreign thing. It's not unusual. And maybe, you know, I might start massing a sort of shadow just for this. If I were in a really good mood, I would I'm not worried that this is green. You know, it's a sort of green by accident, but it's not at all worrisome to me because I don't know how to control phthalo. What is that green in a minute? Just add a little red to it. So that's how I would start. And at this point, I would stop painting. And that's when I really, you know, I have my big explosive emotional putting it down, getting excited. And then I stop. And I kind of shift gears, and I start mixing paint. Because of course, if I'm doing a bigger painting, this phase might take longer than that. But, because for me, this, getting the color harmony going is really part of, it's a very important part of doing the, part of the painting to me. So I would start with this, and I'm looking at that, and I would start with, when I'm making a string of grays. Something neutral. Now, so I'll start with something. This is a combination you use a lot. You could use any two complements, and actually you could use blue really beautiful grays come from blue and either of these blues and burnt umber. What I like to do is make a grid light and phthalo, and I'm making a progression. Start with making a nice progression. So I'm always thinking in terms of light to dark, light to dark. You know, nothing is isolated. There are no isolated thoughts. And right next to it, I'm doing phthalo. This I find such a useful thing. Okay, now what I do is come between them and make a nice string of, wow, sorry, these pigments are not the ones I'm used to working with because I left my paint at home. So I come in between and mix them so I have this wonderful tool on my palette, which is a string of grays, a string of sort of something neutral, and it kind of has a violet cast actually. And at the same time, I have a way to make it warmer and to make it cooler, and also have the grays in the middle. And this is going to prove to be very useful. What I'm literally looking at the still life, what I'm taking this from, is I'm thinking about it, I'm sort of looking at this white placemat and thinking, how am I going to paint that? And thinking, well, I think I'll just use this. So that's the beginning of my harmony. And then, well, you know, let's just jump over to the apple, Granny Smith. And I might, I've painted Granny Smith a million times and I have no formula for it. I never remember what it, to do. I just have a pathway of thinking. So I think, well, it's green. So you might think, actually I'm going to move this over here. So you might think blue and yellow. And in some sense, blue and yellow do make green, but in a much more important sense, blue and yellow and red make green. When you start with, go to blue and yellow, just plain blue and yellow, get a very acid. Notice I'm just constantly working in a progression. You know, I'm never just making a color. So we have this. And you know, that's a green that under electric light, it looks okay, but trust me, it's much too acid. So I can come over here. I already have a range of reds at all different values. And I can just move them over here. And try a little. And start a relationship. As I'm starting the relationship on the palette, I'm making a harmonic that's making relationships in my painting. And as I'm doing that, I'm thinking, oh, here I am. I've got blue, I've got red. Let me just go into that a little more intensely, a little more red here, a little darker blue. And I'm starting to, and a little yellow, and go continue with that yellow. And all of a sudden I have something that begins to represent this pot. And it's flowing right out of the same organization. It's an extension of that thought. So all these things are flowing together. I'm not going to start painting this and then kind of have an isolated spot on the palette that, you know, this is the pot color. You know, this is the apple color. Because they're really all part of a harmonic system. You know, it's like a symphony. You know, it's all fitting together. Because I don't want to just copy this like coloring book. I want to recreate the visual music of it. So here's my pot already there, ready to relate to everything else. And it's even, you know, physically located near it so that I can move these things together. And if you look at the still life, you can see that when I start mixing paint for a still life like this, the first few things I'm sort of, you know, thinking about, you know, I see the white cloth and I have the thing and I have the green, and then all of a sudden everything else just leaps out of it. You know, they just seem to come to life. So for instance, let's talk about the yellow onions. Well, I just finished a whole thing about ochres and phthalo and cadmium. So here I have this string of phthalo and all these values here, and it seems to sort of just be sort of, you know, crying out to have me, you know, come over with something like this, and you know, start developing, and I can borrow some. The only thing that's tricky sometimes is getting the organization right. I need to move this over here. I need to move that over there. But you can see how you can start developing some tonalities and going right up the scale. Start developing a palette for the onions, for the yellow onions. And then what remains? Well, we have the purple onions, but, well, seems pretty easy. Well, how are we going to get there? That's a great pathway. What about the shadow for the onions? So if I go into, I think, shadow for the onions, let me go down here darker into that. So we're down here. I would just take some alizarin and some ultramarine. That happening. Yeah, now I want more phthalo. And by doing it this way, I can also start to see right on my palate and even mix these two onions together because they affect each other. They're, and you know, I just sat down one day and started mixing paint and I started to really develop these ideas. And I realized that with my temperament, I'm just more of a colorist than Thomas. You know, this is something I have to, and that I could get a kind of vitality and vibration into my work by expanding the color harmonics. And, it's so funny because Tom would come and he'd see me doing this. He said, I don't know how you have the patience for that. And Tom will spend, I mean, it wasn't evident yesterday because he did it so fast, but Tom will spend a huge amount of time on the palette just working with the medium and working with the brush and getting it just right to get that perfect stroke. And I just don't know how do you have the patience for that. But, you know, you have the patience for the thing that is your artistic temperament, you know, that suits what you have. The way you are in the world, you know, it's your talent, it's your way your mind works, your body works, your sensibility works. And so yes, I always do this, and it's part of the painting for me. Now the question we've usually asked at this point is that enough paint to do the painting? No, really isn't. And the one thing, I'm gonna interrupt myself for a minute, the thing I've left out, one of the most important parts of this painting is the background. The background is all of these things in the middle value. Scoop it all up, and you know, the background is so important. It's a resonator for all of these harmonics, and it just falls out of this. It's just, you know, it's all of these middle values. You can put any of them into it, it all works. So it is not nearly enough paint to do the painting. But once I've done this, I've internalized, you know, now I understand it. You know, I have internalized the harmony of this painting, and I know the pathways. I still, as I said, you know, for some whatever reason, my students are starting to really laugh at me. Every time I have a still life workshop, I mean, the two things I always buy, Tom always buys a huge bunch of green grapes, a huge bunch of red grapes. He uses two of each one. I always buy Granny Smith apples and pears because I can't set up a still life without those. And many times as I've painted them, I can't remember what colors. I really can't remember because it's not what I'm thinking about, how to do it. So for me, it's, you know, and those aren't isolated. You know, it's the whole harmonic. And now I've internalized it, and now I understand the pathway. That's where I was going with that Granny Smith thing. It's not about knowing what the form, you know, what do you mix to get that? It's about understanding the overall, internalizing the overall harmony of this painting for me. So that's how I start, and then in about three strokes it's gone. And, but that's okay, because I know how to get it back. And I know where I'm going with it. So let me try to put a few of those three strokes on. Right, so now I need way more paint. So I'll just scoop up all of Tom's beautiful, expensive old Holland paint. Oh, I feel so bad about that. And it's going maybe a little. So yeah, I'm incapable of mixing one tonality. So I'm starting to think, well, let me just, you know, at a certain point in starting a still life, you know, you just gotta get in there and mass in all the different elements. And I'm, since this pot is staring me in the face, I'm gonna start with that. So I started mixing the middle value for that, building on what I've already thought out. Can't stop at that. I do the middle value, it went up a little bit with res, and I'm gonna go down the shadow, which I've made a very dark alizarin and phthalo shadow, so that no matter what I'm working on, when I'm working on it, there's always a scale involved. You know, I always have a thought of middle, dark, light, or light, dark, middle. You know, it's never an isolated thought, because, you know, there are no isolated thoughts in painting. Everything is relative. So I'm starting in the middle. So I made this little mini scale and go right into the middle. I do believe in putting the highlight early with some potato food early and take it out. So you can. God, silence is deafening. Somebody crack a joke. Something. Now, if I were painting this with great care in my studio, I might not be this free, but the principle is there. Okay, 1 minute of massing, and we can really model something. So, the background. Let's just take everything and put it in the middle. Okay, so I'm doing the background, and I want to get the background going, and I'm literally just scooping up practically everything I have. And the background has light on it, of course. So let's move it up to value. Thank you. Okay, so, the other great thing about the system is you can always go to Plan B if you feel like Plan A isn't what you wanted. So I put that down and I thought, oh my god, that looks too green. So I'm going to start some orange and blue, which is another set of complements, and just try and that to the side. Let's try that for the background, see how that works. Carefully brought these onions from Vermont, and then when I got here, this had a whole beautiful thing. They were braided up here. It's just like somebody had shorn it off. So I unbraided it and tried to fluff it. Here I can. I'm just holding a small stick uselessly. I love cast shadows in still life. I think you can really just have amazing fun with them. So we have a beautiful one back here behind it. It's going to set off the stalks of the onions. So I had was trying to think of something profound to say during this demo. And I think, and in the middle of the night, I think I came up with one. So I'll try it out on you. And that was, I forgot to use it while I was doing, while I was mixing the palette. But my thought was, you know, especially, you know, when you're doing representational painting or realism, so to speak, you know, the tendency is to think, you know, am I making it the way, you know, it really is? You know, there's a rightness about, you know, this is the way it looks. And, you know, what's the reality? You know, I need to make it real and make it right. And, of course, there is no answer to what is real. That doesn't work. And it suddenly struck me that, you know, what you're really doing as an artist is you're answering the question, what is real, you know, in your way. You know, that's your statement. You know, this is what I see as reality. You know, I see the color, you know, I see the texture, you know, this light. I mean, who knows what this really is? If we're all the size of molecules, it would just be a big swirl of energy. And if we were, you know, the size of elephants, it would be a crumb of dust. So, you know, we've been very conditioned by photography to feel like, you know, it needs to be, no, no, that's what is real, but that's actually, you know, the point of view of the camera. So I just think it's just something to think about, you know, as you're, it doesn't mean you can't, you know, come in, and I, you know, although I, you know, I certainly advocate starting with a lot of looseness, it's not that there's never a moment when you're painting a still life that you can't, you know, go, you know, is it right? But just realize that that's because you set something up that has a certain proportion that is pleasing to you, and you want to make sure you get that proportion in your painting, not because it has to be accurate in that way, because, you know, reality says it's that way, and therefore, you know, you have to be, you know, obedient to it as an artist. You know, on the contrary, you know, you don't. So, that's my something to think about, and that's really, you know, really is the excitement of being an artist. After all, is, you know, you get to do that. You get to put it out there. But using a mall stick, just that. Actually leaning on it. Of course, they still have some, you know, because the palette is a mess. That will bring everything up a little bit, sorry. Because this platform thing is dark, but not. But it's in the light for the most part. The shadow. So I just had a moment where, you know, I'm looking at this and, oh my God, it's too phthalo. I'm just going to some more red to balance it. You know, that's really, you know, it's something I, you know, always love my students to get. It's just, you know, it's just to understand how to, you know, if it's too green, throw some red in there. If it's too red, throw some green. You know, if it's too blue and too yellow, then it needs more red. You know, it's really, actually, very simple. You know, in some ways painting is, and color is very easy. It's just, you know, you just need to know, put your hands on the keys to it. You know, understanding that everything is, you know, basically either warm, cool, you know, complements or triads or red, you know, some version of red, blue, and yellow. It's just not, it's not a,
in the past couple of years, your work has gotten semi-abstract. I love it.
Thank you.
I think it gives your still life so much movement.
Thank you.
Is there any reason why you...
Why I did that?
Why your style's changing so much? Like,
well, it's a great question. It's something that just sort of happened and emerged. And actually, the first one I did, you know, it had been something sort of percolating for a long time. Oh, thank you, Walter. Lots and lots. Great, thank you. Wonderful. It was percolating for a long time, sort of a corner of my mind. You know, I kept sort of seeing little abstracts. And of course, the amount of time I spend on the palette, you really start seeing things happening. You see things emerge. It's mesmerizing, really, to kind of, I would recommend everybody, this is a really nice kind of knife, a mixing knife, and just spending some time with your paint and seeing what you can make. And so something starts to happen. It starts speaking to you because, you know, I always say if I get really hard up for money, I'll just start a series of just the palette, you know, just mixing, you know, you could, because it's so abstract itself. So it was sort of percolating. And then 2010, so 4 years ago, I'd done a big still life, big classical still life, you know, beautiful painting. Worked on it for 3 weeks, you know, it's very finished, flowers, blah, 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 beautiful painting. And I wasn't satisfied, you know, it was something about it. And it was a Thursday, Tom was off teaching in New York, so I sort of had the, you know, I was completely alone, which helped, and you know, in that moment. And I just picked up another canvas, much smaller, and put down, and I all things I hadn't, all the unexpressed feeling, all everything I hadn't didn't feel I got into that still life, and I just gave myself, on the one hand, gave myself permission to do, put down whatever came, and at the same time I think this is very artificial, but I did it for about the first year of abstracts, and it really helped me. I also just never went back. I said, you know, once you put it down, make something out of it. You know, no looking back. You know, I just put everything down. I moved ahead. And I just want semi-abstract and called it Water Matrix. You know, it has, it was, you know, I could see it was an abstracted version of the still life. Most people didn't notice that. And so I did that, and I was very excited, and Tom loved it. And I had my woman who represented me then and represents me now, who's quite amazing, who had been selling my, you know, fairy representational paintings for 15 years. I had her over to dinner one night, and I just propped it up in the corner and see what she would think, and came in, and she's talking, and she heard her, and she went, oh my God, what is that? She said, ah, I love this. I said, really? I'm thrilled. And then I actually didn't do another one for about 6 months or a year, and then it just started gradually, you know, I just started, and then at some point, I did, like, had an amazing moment when I did, like, 3 or 4 months, I just did, you know, a whole body of work. And it's been very exciting.
Yeah, they're beautiful.
It's been very exciting. It's, it just feels like
birch trees. And
oh, thank you. Really, but it really feels to me, you know, representational painting is, you know, I think is insufficiently recognized the profound abstraction that's in it and how important it is to represent representational painting to see the abstraction and things. You know, the massing, the light. You know, the big ideas. You know, that Tom was talking about. I mean, it really. That's why I love to say representational, not realism. You know, it's you know, my favorite representational painting, you know, of course, comes from this sort of large point of view, and I think that it's just sort of a, you know, a continuum. And I don't really think those are two points. I don't think those two points of view are really at war. They're not for me. You know, for me they're the same, and it's just a different way of seeing. You know, when I do the abstracts, I see a. You know, to me, the realism, you know, I see the world, you know, some part of me sees the world that way, and I couldn't keep painting in a minute, but just like I was saying before, you know, if you were, you know, the solidity, you know, is an illusion, obviously, I mean, it's not mysticism, it's science, you know, we know that everything really is pure energy. If you were the size of an atom, everything would just be swirling energies, and most of my abstractions are really, they've developed to be very much built on that, you know, they just come out of this sort of vibrational expression of what I'm seeing, you know, combined. Because I also think it's, you know, and that's just me. I like seeing things in a layered way. You know, I see things representationally, but I also see things in another way. And I think a lot of people do, or people wouldn't respond to them. So, you know, I think that's probably something, a way a lot of people see things, because otherwise they wouldn't look at those abstracts and recognize them as something like, oh, yeah, it's exciting because I see things that way too. So it's been, but it has very much come, but I think for me it's also, you know, this has been really huge, because this is this mixing, way of mixing paint and this attention to the, to all these different vibrations in the paint, subtlety, you know, begins to, it develops a world. It's a, you know, it's an abstraction of reality, and it develops a life of its own. And so it's sort of an extension of it. I think it just kind of progressed onto the canvas. So basically, it just happened. I have no idea. Something that just happened. But it's been great, and I'm very excited about it. It's, that painting in the show is, it's been a long time since I just did a painting that was just, and I didn't intend it to be. That was actually really funny, because a friend of mine gave me these incredible dahlias, and I thought, oh, well, I'll take them home and I'll make a great, you know, semi-abstraction out of them, like the one that I love of mine, a painting that I love of mine, of the daffodils called Flurry, you know, which is the night. And I sort of wanted to do something else in that vein, and I got those flowers. And that painting did not want to be an abstraction. It wouldn't go there. It didn't go there. And I'm like, yeah, fine. Whatever. Whatever you want. Whatever the painting wants, the painting gets. Okay, let me move my apples to a better place. So I'm back to my thing here. And so at this point, wake up from my dream of mixing and vibrations, and I'm like, God, the apple's too far to the right. Yeah, but you still want to get the apple in the right place. I want to get the apple in the right place, because it's leaving a gap and it's making me, annoying me, so let me just fix that. It should be over here. It should be over here. And all back together. My mother, who's here, used to tell me, she probably doesn't remember, that in law school, they teach you a spiral, didactic spiral. You start teaching everything and then you go closer and closer and closer to the truth. So painting is kind of the same. So we got everything going, and now we're going back to give everything greater life, greater depth. For instance, we had, of course, moved those apples over, which were such a the wrong place. And now, you know, I also can see that this pot is completely the wrong shape. It's just, it's too dark. Correct that, just get my drawing a little bit more accurate, because this is actually quite important. I think that this pot is all together. Everything is all together lacking in one way or another. There we go. It's better. Okay, so let me get into some nuts and bolts painting. Here we have what I'm mixing up for this pot, and I'm going to go up towards the light, and to me, as it goes into the light, it's getting warmer. It gets more of that sort of, there's a brown. The whole thing is made out of course, red, blue, and yellow. And that said, as we go towards the shadow, it's getting richer and more towards the blue-violet in here. Let's just stop and analyze this for a minute. The light is coming over the left shoulder on the top plane, so we have highlight and this warm light in here. And then you can see from the profile that this starts to turn down, so an underplane from here to here. And that underplane is suffused, of course, with reflected light from the placemat. So that means, and over here we have reflected light coming from the onions. So we have light here on the top plane. We have kind of middle value through here. It's hard to see because it's shiny, but that's the art of painting, is being able to see. One of the important skills of painting, I should say, is to be able to understand the form, the structure, despite all of the accidents of light and reflections and artificial lights and chandeliers that are going on. So it's really important to understand, instead of just, you know, copying it tone by tone, the dynamic that's happening here. So again, you have light, you have highlight, you have middle value, and the sort of the most shadow is really going to be sort of in here. This is going to be where it's richest, because the light from the light source is diminishing from here to here, and then the reflected light is greatest sort of under here and coming from here, and that's also diminishing, you know, from here to here. So that leaves this kind of area as the richest part of the form, the most color and the most darkness. And then of course there's, you know, actual shadow underneath. And that basic analysis applies to everything you're painting. You know, that's just the fundamental planes of light. And, you know, I think that the ability to see that along with just mastering value control are, you know, once you can do that, you've really great advance in painting. You know, you're sort of, yeah, in some sense, you can paint anything. I remember Frank would always be there in the classroom and wading through the mud, and Frank would come in and put all look great in two strokes, and he would say, "It's so easy." And I'm like, "Really?" really doesn't feel easy from here, Frank. But he's, you know, he was just saying what was the reality for him. It was easy. And actually, when if you, you know, it is actually easy. Oh, we have a concert. Being serenaded. So I'm basically just building that form, as you can see, in the light across it. And I can always bring the reflected light back in. I'm just sort of easing up on the pressure of the brush as I go towards that, what's going to be a wall of reflected light coming in. Anybody have anything to chat about?
What do you do when you're feeling frustrated?
Oh, I have a weeping fit. It's a really good question. Much less frequently than I used to. But there are times you really have to give myself a very big critique. And, you know, as I'm demolishing in the nicest possible way, the paintings of my students, I say to them, you know, I did this to myself last week. And it's true, because, you know, there are times when you have to, I don't know who asked the question, because I was doing the, oh, okay. You know, there, you kind of have to judge the quality of the frustration. You know, there are different kinds of frustration. So one thing to do is walk away from it. I mean, a friend of mine, Kim Darling, once said to me, she said, you know when you're painting with been painting with one crumpled up paper towel in your hand for 2 hours that you need to take a break. So if that's what's going on, you really need to take a break, you need to get some hydration, you need to come back. Sometimes you're really struggling, you have to figure out what's going on. Sometimes you're struggling because you painted one thing well, and you're afraid. I mean, the biggest obstacle in painting, the thing that is terrible, holds you back as an artist, is fear. And that's usually always, in some way, the problem, that you're afraid to really do what on some level you know you need to do, because you're trying to keep it looking nice and you're afraid it's going to stop looking nice. Or you've done some part you really liked, everything else is wrong and you're trying to protect that. Or you're just basically afraid. And, you know, it's happened to me many, many times, and almost every time I'm really, really balled up in frustration. What I do is, you know, I break through the fear by really just taking a brush and taking the painting apart. And, you know, if I'm that frustrated, then the painting needs to be taken apart and put back together again. And I've been afraid to do that. And I just do it. And it's often because you're on the edge of being able to work with bigger ideas in your painting than you have been before. But you're just on that edge, you're afraid to do it, you're frustrated, you're stuck. You can break through that. It's usually very liberating, very helpful, and it takes your painting to a much better place. It's often a really good sign, you know, you're kind of on the verge of going somewhere, but you have to break through the fear. So after I have the weeping fit, which, believe me, I do, and, you know, then, you know, I usually take a big brush and I remap, you know, whatever needs to be done, because on some level you do know what needs to be done, and usually, you know, it's remassing, or it's putting the light on with more force, or it's, but, you know, it's something you're afraid to do. And so I would recommend doing that, you know, be merciless, because it's just, you know, you're always going to do another painting. And, but fear is the big enemy. Fear is really the thing that will do. I mean, fear is very useful in life, but not in painting. You know, sometimes it's useful in life, keeps you from doing something really stupid. But it's just painting, so it's not going to kill you, and it's, I have yet to see a use for it in painting. I think it's the bad thing, it's the thing to learn to get out of.
Yeah.
That's a great question.
Just getting started.
So what I'm seeing from, I don't know what you're seeing from your angle, but from where I am, there's a huge reflected light from this apple going into the pot, whatever it is. So I get up, I eat breakfast, I walk the dog, and I go to the studio. That's pretty much the routine. And I remember when I was a student, you know, some other students saying to me, you know, don't you ever feel, you know, it's good to take a break from painting and not paint for 6 months or 3 months or something. And I watched this person, and she took a break from painting, and, you know, she came back and she was better. And I thought, wow, you know, this probably actually really works, except that I don't want to stop painting. You know, it's just... You know, I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing. It might actually help, but, you know, not painting is not really what I want to do. Okay, so what I'm doing here, as I was looking at this apple and thinking about starting to do some more serious modeling, as the light, you know, I'm seeing, you know, of course, the big light here, it's wonderful opacity, you can see how it starts to wash out. And then as we, and here, you know, we've talked about that, but as you come across here, right in this area, again, just as in this part of this form, this is where the color, it's always the area of the richest color. Because as you go towards the light itself bleaches the color. As you go towards the shadow, of course, it's absorbed by the shadow. So the richest color is in the low middle values. And in particular, in something like a piece of fruit, or like a human figure especially, the light is also subtly passing through. There's a translucence to it because the light is passing through. A little too far with, too warm there. But so we have something that's my basic middle low rich. Let me just check the value. It's actually a little too high in pitch. Greens, but I've sort of stopped and building. Some tonalities here that are in very close value, and. You know, it's green that's a little blue, and green that's a little red, and green that's a little more yellow. You know, I mean, what is color? What is local color? Oh, a long conversation about that. So, in order to develop that area. But let's start by establishing the light there. So I'm going back up to this almost a high violet, white. You see how even on the palette, we're started in the middle, as I start to kind of get ready to put on some powerful lights so that my middle values will look right, you can just kind of see it shift on the palette. You know, it's kind of amazing, isn't it? You can see the light come into the palette. Tom always says, and he's absolutely right, it's not happening on the palette, you know, what's happening on the palette is happening in the painting. So for me, that was, you know, my development as an artist, so important to really get control of the palette, get control of the painting. So let's, I'm thinking about painting this, but to get that, first I'm going to go and really reestablish building up a fair amount of paint there to get the higher. Notice that the highlight is always where the planes meet. So it's, you know, we have a donut, you know, an apple of course is sort of a donut sitting on top of a sphere with an end on it. So as we go across the donut and breaks to go to the inside, that's why the highlight is here in this ring. That's where those planes meet. and we can go. So it's catching on this side of the donut ring, it's turning out of light, but on the opposite side, of course, we're turning into light. So if you see up here, and now I know I'm planning to get there, but up here I'm going to a high, very high red, high pink, against all of this green as I develop this light and see how it starts to take some of the, starts to make this more interesting, more alive. And I could, you know, add a little yellow at the same, all almost all at the same value, just developing the light. And then here's the advantage of my setup. As I go across the top of the apple, I can drop, I can just pick up some of this grayer tonality at that value. And
so the yellow is part of your highlight?
The yellow? Yeah. The yellow is the light under the highlight. That highlight's on top of it. So the yellow. So we're simultaneously painting the object, you know, it's an apple, it's a green apple, and also painting the light. I mean, they're not really separable. They're one of the same. And you can't perceive the apple without perceiving the light. You know, what does that look like velvet? It's a great question. And you know, my first response would be value relationships, because everything's value relationships. But it's also something in the brushwork, it's in the texture of the brushwork. It's even in the contrast between the velvet itself and that edging on it, you know, that triggers, you know, those rich tones looking right. So, you know, it's many, many things together. And particularly things that are sort of tricky like velvet or reflected light. It's amazing how much the illusion depends on some just subtle characteristic of the brushwork, like. So, endlessly fascinating.
Do you always use bristle brushes? Do you ever use?
Do I ever use what? Something else? Synthetic? Sable?
Sable.
I do use sable sometimes, but usually in small paintings. You know, if I'm doing a, I have some sables here. I actually made sure I had some, because I thought I was going to do a tiny little painting. Usually on small paintings, I don't use big sables, because I think it's too, you can't get it, you know, you can't, I mean, what a sable can't do is hold a lot of paint, so you can't get the whole opacity, transparency, dynamic. It's not something you're going to get out of a sable. So, I use them for modeling, figures and, you know, anything that's sort of delicate and subtle, and, you know, every now and then it's. So let me not avoid the onions forever. It's such an exciting thing to paint. So I thought it was a little crazy to bring onions to paint because it's so tricky. But I hate painting anything that's not exciting. And I find onions so exciting. I think they're so beautiful. Brains. So, why not? And it's very much like painting a group of grapes. Or following the palette.
You won't be there.
The whole palette is never getting out of control, so I can actually bring more richness into this. And I might even, I'm going to try this, see if it works. As I always say, I'm teaching, well, I'm going to try this, see if it works. If it doesn't, we'll try something else. But theoretically, I'm also thinking that I can increase the sense of vibration and color by putting, you know, finding a nice gray, actually in some ways making the light on it a little less vibrant. So I'm here in orange and blue, which is another set of complements. I'm making a different kind of a gray than I started out, than the phthalo and red light. It's still sort of an interesting one. Let's just see. I'd help to clean the brush. Yes, I do. So you notice I sort of got rid of the highlight, put it back, got rid of it again, continued to develop the plane, and now I'll just put it back. You do that to all the other onions? We go to a... Not and talk. Right.
It's wonderful.
Oh.
It's great.
Just say now, I'm not going to paint every one of these onions by 8:30. This is not happening. But we need to owe it to ourselves to at least do a purple one. See, it's all close values at the moment, but I'm actually putting quite a bit of paint in the center of the form where the light, you know, it's going to support the highlight, middle light. And like everything, it's tricky because there's a big reflected light, there's a shadow, and then there's a big reflected light, and of course, I mean, skin is, by definition, very reflective. But I'm going to try not to be too thoroughly seduced by this, by the reflected light yet, too quickly. again, and go to the blue at the same, basically the same value. Too dark. Same value that is too low. And then I'm going back to the gray. It's sort of alizarin. Now it's an alizarin phthalo, which is a beautiful violety gray. I highly recommend playing around with. It's actually wonderful in landscape because it's and just top of that. So let's go into there's a reflected light. I'm going to try the blue, sort of blue orange and a little alizarin in there at this low sort of reflected light value, which is of course lighter than shadow, considerably darker than light. It has that sort of magical, let's see if that. Really accented phthalo and alizarin if you ever want a really dark moment. That will do it. But you know, you could just, it's the most fun thing in the world. Just sit here, you know, at this point and start. Here we have this beautiful something in between. It's up higher than that just dark accent I put in. Because there's that onion back here that's just sort of sitting back. It's got 8:16. I've got 15 minutes left, 14 minutes left. I'm going to do a little something before I could paint these onions all day. But let's just say something about the braid. I just can't bring a braid to a party and not make some effort to paint it. It's just cheating. So, well, it's really very similar to the background, right? So we're talking about something that's a, you know, wonderful neutral middle value. And it's right going right back to my roots of this painting, which is right here in the middle, right at the middle of everything. Let's get some smush going. And this is really a place where a good textured white with just the right weight would be a huge help, you can imagine, because there's really, oh my God, you think what Franz Hals would do with that, you know, it's really, brushwork is important, and to have the brushwork properly, you have to have the right weight of paint. But that's okay, we can do a lot with values as well. And let me just see where I am. Nice, we're right here in the middle. Little middle light. That's there. So that tells me, you know, it looks so light here, but of course we have very confusing lighting. And what it tells me is I can actually go up much higher. Not much higher, but higher. I can certainly go up to there. That's actually more like, that's more accurate. That's yellow. Light value. So let's just go up there, and I, you know, if I had a tad of middle, so I've started some light, and let's go to the other side. I'll just use this for shadows. This is perfectly. Just paper towel. It's so soft. It's really going to be counterproductive. I actually love to do this kind of thing. It can take a lot of time. You know, sometimes I've really gone to town with baskets with drapery with brocade on it, and it's like I actually really enjoy painting. It can take a lot of time. You know, sometimes it can take a week to really develop a complicated piece of drapery or really basket weave, but it's fun. You know, it shouldn't just be labor. You know, it's just like developing the rhythms and the beautiful, the wonderfully. You know, we don't have time, and I'm sure everyone's exhausted. Complex, subtle color harmonics, that happen. You know, it's just beautiful. Subtleties of neutrality, and then a moment where a jolt of opacity. You know, that's what's so exciting about anything that's sort of like straw. But I always recommend to students, it's the kind of thing you need to do when you feel well rested and you have a clear mind. it takes patience and focus, and there's just a certain energy that you want to be in when you start trying to follow weaves and patterns and things. And it also just drives you nuts. I think this thing's moved. Sure it has. This was not hanging out over here. Which is its privilege. Never, ever, ever paint a tulip unless you make shoes. God. Has anybody ever tried to paint a tulip? They really move. I mean, from one minute to the next, they're just bobbing and weaving and talking trash. I'm still basically massing values. You know, I'm seeing, there's a little clump, and keeping in mind all the time, where the planes are, what direction, things are facing, and what the relative value is. But it's just all happening. At once. Okay, so I just created a middle. I had a shadow on my brush, and I went into a light with it, so I just took, I wanted that middle value, so simple. Thank you. Very little money. But it's the same principle. It's a very soft bristle, so it makes a very smooth surface so that your brush strokes don't catch light. But I just don't paint that way. I just don't like it. It's not what I do. I don't like it. I like things like my brush strokes to stick out and catch all the dust and people know they're there. It is 8:31, so thank you for your patience. Thank you, everybody.